Amen. Now, good morning and welcome to worship. Welcome to Franklin Community Church. I'm David Husseltine, the pastor here, and I'm glad you decided to join us for this time of worship and praise. And as we begin, a couple announcements I want to share. We're trying to put together a directory for the church with names and addresses and other information, so you can see on the screen the information we're trying to receive. So if you've filled out the form already, fantastic. But if not, please contact the office and Delia can get that information to you, or at least the form, so you can get filled out and send it back to the church. Well, this past week on PBS, they aired two segments of a documentary about the Black church. And I watched it, and it was very fascinating, learned a lot of things. And hopefully you might have watched it. If not, it's still on PBS. If you go on their website, you just type in Black church and you can follow the link. But next Sunday, Dr. Althea Simpson will lead a discussion about that documentary. And she's going to have other participants, an African-American pastor and some others. And I think it'll be a great discussion. So please watch the documentary, contact Dr. Simpson so she can send you the link to be part of that conversation next Sunday. This coming Wednesday, I began a Lenten study looking at the Beatitudes. And again, it's going to be via Zoom. And it's from 7 to 8 o'clock at night. And if you'd like to participate, just again, let me know and with your email address, and I will send you the Zoom link, and we can have that conversation. Again, even if you can't be with us all 6 weeks during Lent, if you can just pop in and let me know the weeks you're available, that would be fantastic. And finally, the last announcement is next Saturday, there's going to be a food drive in our church or in the back of the church. This actually is not sponsored by us, but a group of women that do charitable works. But we're invited as a church or as a community, if we want to participate, to bring our items to the back of the church. And I think that's what, from 10 to 11. So again, if we have our groceries, if we're shopping, or we want to go through our pantries, again, an opportunity to support Cass and Baldwin, because some of the food will be going up there in Pontiac. So again, just a heads up of an opportunity we have to be in mission. So it is, again, on a cold day, it's good to be warmed by God's Holy Spirit. And I invite Dr. Althea Simpson to lead us in our call to worship this morning.
Let us stand. We gather this day to worship our God, whose words and ways challenge us.
God invites us to lose our selfishness and to find ourselves.
God calls us to be fools in the world, to show forth the wisdom of Christ.
God urges us to empty ourselves, to discover life's fullness.
God bids us to be obedient to a divine will so we might know true freedom.
We come to worship our Creator, seeking to have our faith challenged into growth.
And now as we remain standing, let us join together in singing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Teach me some, my Lord, yes.
be seated. As we get ready to enter into a time of prayer, I do want to lift up one concern. One of our dear members, Vicki Hurd, she's had a card ministry for years where she's written cards, birthday cards, and Christmas cards, and all kinds of cards. And she's had some health issues recently, and she's not able, because of her handwriting, to do those cards. But I want to lift up Vicki as our concern today, and also encourage folks to send her a card. And just shower her with cards, and I'm sure they'll be a blessing for Vicki. But again, she's a dear spirit and a saint in our church, and we love her, and we want to let her know how much we care for Vicki. But we are going to enter into prayer, but to get our hearts in that right place, I'm going to invite us to sing one verse of More Love to Thee, O Christ. Gracious and loving God, as we gather together in this worship experience, we center our thoughts, our minds on you, recognizing you as the author of life, the source of all goodness. And we praise you, and we're ever grateful for all the ways you touch and bless our lives. And we humbly confess, O Lord, that sometimes we even forget about those blessings. We take for granted all that we have, or maybe we assume that we're the ones are responsible for all that we have. But you love us, you care for us in all of our life's journey. You're there in good times, and when we celebrate life, O Lord, hopefully we include you in those celebrations. But you're especially there when life gets difficult and painful and frustrating, and for many in this country, in this world, that's the state of affairs. Because of the COVID virus, because of cancer, because of natural disasters, because of conflict and war, so many, O Lord, are struggling. And we look to you for strength, for direction, and for healing and hope. And Lord, as we pray together, again, we're mindful that as disease continues to impact lives, cause suffering and even death, and we continue to pray for those that care for those in the hospital, our doctors, nurses, and aides, and our frontline workers as they continue in this fight against this virus. And for those that have the disease, we pray for healing and wholeness, and for, again, the families that are grieving losses in your own way, O Lord, bring comfort. And we pray, O Lord, as a people join together for those in Texas who struggled this past week in cold temperatures, without electricity, without water, and even though things are slowly being restored, there's still a lot of need and suffering there in that state. And we know when one suffers, all suffers. So we pour out our prayers, our hearts, our concerns for those in Texas, but we also know other places in the world where people suffer extreme poverty and distress, and we hold up their concerns as well. And we hold up one another in our own concerns, and I lifted up Vicki Hurd, and we pray for her health and stability and just her wellness, that her and others that may feel alone can be surrounded by your steadfast love and always feel that they're never, never alone. So Lord, journey with us during this season of Lent, that we can grow closer to you, that we can look at ourselves and maybe do something special or significant during these weeks to come to grow just a little bit closer to you, to feel more love between you and us. So these are the prayers, just some of the prayers of your people, and we share them to you in the name of Jesus the Christ. And as we end this time of prayer, we once again join our voices together as we humbly pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, now we would normally take an offering, but as we know, during this time where we don't pass the plates, but there's always opportunities we have to give back out of gratitude to God. So when we do come to in-person worship, we have our offering placed by our doors. But for those that are worshiping at home, we continue to offer the opportunity either to send your offering to the church by check in the mail or online. We have a link there on our webpage to give electronically. But it is so good to give out of gratitude and be blessed as a result of that giving. So let us be in prayer, O Lord. We thank you again and again, all that we have. And you never demand our giving, but you offer us an opportunity to give in response. And in our giving, we are blessed, and others are blessed by those things that we give. So we pray your blessing on the giving and the gifts. In Christ's name, amen.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart I can only imagine when all I will do is forever. I can only imagine.
Our scripture lesson for this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 5th chapter, the 1st through the 10th verses, and it reads as follows. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain. And after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." May God add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of the scripture.
I invite us to pause in a moment of prayer. And now, O Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation, the spirit of all of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, for many years, Jay Leno was the host of Tonight Show. And one of the bits he used to do was go on the street and ask people different questions, just to see their knowledge of geography, science, and politics. It was always humorous. And sometimes a little surprising to see what little things people knew. So I'm wondering if we were to do a person on the street interview today and ask men and women what the Beatitudes were, it'd be interesting to hear their response. Because my guess there'd be a number of folks who'd have no idea what the Beatitudes are. And who knows, maybe somebody watching this morning doesn't know exactly what a Beatitude is. So if you look in Webster's Collegiate Dictionary, you'll find a beatitude is a noun, which means a state of utmost bliss. Now, though that's interesting to know, that really doesn't impact us. But it's the second definition, though, that applies to us. And that is any of the declarations made in the Sermon on the Mount, beginning with the words, "Blessed are." Now, assumed in that definition is that the reader knows what the Sermon on the Mount is. And that's a big assumption, given how many non-religious and nominally religious people there are around us. So we heard the scripture reading this morning. It began by saying, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain. And after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying. So there were crowds coming to Jesus. This tells us that already word had gotten out about Jesus. He had already been going around the countryside teaching and healing people. So folks were curious to see exactly who this Jesus was and hopeful that Jesus would heal them or one of their loved ones. As you also heard, the disciples had already been recruited, that these 12 men left their family and jobs to follow this rabbi or teacher. Now, speaking of teacher, it might seem peculiar when it says that Jesus sat down to teach. Well, back in the Jewish culture in Jesus' day, you would stand to read scripture, but you would sit down to teach. Finally, it said it was on the mountain that Jesus taught. And this teaching covers a lot of subjects. Thus, it was assumed called a sermon. So this, friends, is how we get the description Sermon on the Mount. So Jesus begins this Sermon on the Mount with 8 statements, and each begin with the word blessed. Well, as the Bible was slowly put together, this section of Matthew began being referred to as the Beatitudes. And again, as time went by and section titles were added to the Bible, our printed Bibles, the Beatitudes stuck. And that was what we call these teachings of Jesus. So now that we're on the same page about the Beatitudes, let me share you what one person said about them. The Beatitudes, they are character-building callings from the Master himself to take up a sacred quest to become the person God created you to be. Let me read that again. It's character-building callings from the Master himself to take up a sacred quest to become the person that God created you to be. Well, this past Wednesday, we in the Christian faith began a journey, a 6-week journey that we call Lent. These days leading up to Easter are a time when we are invited to examine ourselves to see if we are the person that God created us to be. And given the statement I just read, I thought it would be helpful to spend this season of Lent looking at the Beatitudes. So, what do these blessed statements say? How can we connect with these qualities? Now, I use the word qualities, but they can also be viewed as attitudes. One way I've heard the Beatitude described is as a be attitude. That God wants his attitude to be in us. Now, this rather clever division of the word Beatitudes caught my attention, and I decided to expand it further for my sermon title for this sermon series. And that is being the Beatitudes. For as I said, God wants these attitudes to be in all of us. So I presented my sermon to Diane, who does the PowerPoint, and as she was reading it over, she decided, she had inspiration to design a graphic of this generic person that you see in the screen with all the different attitudes made up in that person. And as we go through these attitudes in the weeks to come, you'll see why Diana put these attitudes in different parts of the body. But for now, let's put our model down at the corner of the screen. As a reminder, for us, our goal during Lent is being the Beatitudes. Now, one word of caution here, or maybe information, there's 8 Beatitudes, but there's only 6 Sundays in Lent. So that means I'm not going to go in depth in all 8 of these Beatitudes. But as I said in the announcements, I am going to have a Lent study, and each of these Beatitudes will be looked at in depth. So I encourage you to join me in the study, and again, via Zoom, Wednesday nights beginning at 7 o'clock. And again, contact me and I'll send you the link. So as we are addressing the Beatitudes during Lent, every Sunday during Lent, the scripture reading will be the exact same. We'll be hearing Matthew 5, verses 1 through 10. And my hope, friends, is we hear this scripture for 6 straight weeks. By the end of this period of Lent, by Easter, we'll know the Beatitudes by heart. But we know there's different translations of the Bible. So my plan is each Sunday to have us hear a different translation of the Beatitudes to see what variations there might be. For example, today we heard the New Revised Standard Version. And that's the version we usually use here on Sunday morning here at our church. But again, as we go along, you'll notice the differences. Take, for example, how they begin. The New Revised Standard says, "Blessed are those." Blessed are those. The New Living Translation says, "God blesses those." The Today's English Version says, "Happy are those." 3 different translations, 3 little different beginnings. Now I confess, I like the New Living Translation. I use that version for my Bible study and readings every day. But I don't really agree with how that is displayed. Because whereas the New Revised Standard says, "Happy and blessed are those," the New Living Translation says, "God blesses those." God bless, and that kind of implies that because you believe, God will bless you. And that's not really how I think this translation is meant to be heard. Because in Latin, the word beatus means either to be happy or blessed. The implication, I believe, that Jesus was making, that if we live out these attitudes, that we're going to have a sense of happiness and blessedness that goes way beyond our current circumstances. Now, it's described in other places in the Bible as a peace that passes all understanding. A peace that passes all understanding, because it's a different kind of thing that we experience in the world, that the world expects. So friends, these character-building callings or attitudes that we call the Beatitudes result in a special kind of feeling that we can have. The Greeks called Beatitudes, and it's akin to what Webster's called a state of utmost bliss. It's a state, again, you can't explain exactly what it is, but you know it when you feel it. So when we live out these Beatitudes, these attitudes, then again, we are able to experience this joy, this peace that passes all understanding. So now let's look at the first beatitude. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So what does it mean to be poor in spirit? Now it's curious again that the New Living Translation misses the mark, because what it says is that God blesses those who are poor and realize their need for God. That God blesses those who are poor. So is Jesus really glorifying the poor? Now, God does have a special place for those who are struggling, those that are poor. But being in need of food, of shelter, and other necessities is not what Jesus is addressing in this beatitude. Ironically, though, in the New Living Translation, when it says God blesses the poor, there's actually a footnote that says in Greek, it's translated poor in spirit. So why they left out the in spirit part, no one knows. But poor in spirit, one might read that statement and think, well, does Jesus want us to have little faith, right? To be poor means having very little of something. So is Jesus encouraging us to spend a little time in prayer, a little time in Bible study, a little time in worship? I don't think so. Because poor in spirit is actually the result of being rich in faith. And let me explain what I mean by that. Being poor in spirit is recognizing how mighty God is and how dependent we are on God. It's about understanding that God knows what's best for us and letting go of some of the control that we have in our lives. Now, that's hard to do, isn't it? We like to think that we're in charge and we know what's best for us. In fact, our culture holds us this ideal of a self-made man, independent and successful, and that's what we should strive for. But Jesus is saying that when we think more about God and less about ourselves, that we can find peace and contentment. That when our egos are dropped in favor of grateful participation in the building of the kingdom of God, things will be best. Well, as we move through the Beatitudes, we'll explore the different attitudes, what gives us this feeling of peace. But for today, we're called to look at this primary outlook that we take in consideration in our relationship with God. Why do we relate to God? Why do we honor God? Why do we worship God? What's our motivation? Now, if the motivation we have to submit ourselves to God is we feel pressured, or it's out of fear that we decide to follow God, then this blessing does not apply to us. Because, friends, it's those outside forces that are compelling us to believe in God. But, on the other hand, if it's out of awe and wonder, that we decide to give God God's rightful authority over our lives, then indeed we are poor in spirit and we are part of that great kingdom of God. So friends, during these weeks ahead, during this season of Lent, this quest we are, can we think about who exactly is driving our life? Are we the pilot in charge? And every once in a while we look to God, our co-pilot, to give us some help. Is that how we operate? Or do we consistently be amazed and awed at the power of God and submit ourselves to God's will? Now again, back to our figure here. It's interesting that Diana got poor in spirit in our model's arm. Well, this is his right hand. If you're right-handed, it's your dominant hand. If you're left-handed, think of this as the left arm, the left hand. Because we do a lot of wonderful things, right, with our hands, with our hands, with our arms. But we do a lot of things, especially with our dominant hand. And we might think that the things we do with our hands are due to our own abilities, that we are in control. But it's exactly that kind of control that we need to give over to God. And we need to say, God, you are in control. I submit myself to lead me and guide me into things, decisions that I need to make. That I want you, God, to be my control center. Now, speaking of control center, this past week, NASA's Perseverance rover landed safely on Mars. I mean, it's just astounding, right? If you think about it, after a six-month journey, almost 300 million miles, this craft with this rover landed safely on the planet of Mars. And it's now sending us pictures of Mars. It just boggles the mind. Now, the rover did the landing, but where was its control center? Maybe a little bit on the rover, but the control center was back here in the United States. That's where the control center is. So maybe that's the image, the analogy we need to use, that maybe God is our control center, right? Not us. We have some say, but ultimately we need to look to God for that direction, for that guidance. So there's a lot of illustrations, a lot of lessons to be learned from outer space. Because again, the wonderful song, I Can Only Imagine, right? Beautiful song about heaven. But we can only imagine how vast God's universe is. I mean, think, it took 300 million miles for that spacecraft to go to Mars, and that's not even the furthest planet in our solar system. And there's solar systems even beyond that. It just boggles the mind to think that God's hand was in the creation of all that there is. Now, speaking of space, over the years, there's been a number of men and women that have been fortunate enough to go into space, astronauts, either on the space station or some even have landed on the moon and walked on the moon. And all these astronauts, when they come back, they share how changed they are because of this experience. Well, there's two astronauts who wrote about this experience, and both of them walked on the moon. This one statement says, "It suddenly struck me that this tiny pea, pretty and blue, was the Earth. I put up my thumb and shut one eye, and my thumb blotted out the planet Earth. I didn't feel like a giant. I felt very, very small." That was Neil Armstrong. And then this quote, "To look out at this kind of creation out here and not believe in God is to me impossible. It just strengthened my faith. I wish there was words to describe what it's like." And that was John Glenn. Now, friends, being poor in spirit is recognizing just how insignificant we are and how mighty God is. Now, earlier I was critical of my New Living Translation where it says, "Blessed those who are poor." But listen how it ends that statement. God blesses those who are poor in spirit, but then realize their need for God. They realize their need for God. That's what it means to be poor in spirit. So friends, I know it's cold out there, but my encouragement for us is if at night, if it's a clear night, to go outside and to look up into the heavens, and just spend some time pausing at the heavens, and then come inside and then read Psalm 8, verses 3 and 4. "When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals that you should think of them, human beings that you should care for them?" Friends, in that psalm is the spirit of what it means to be poor in spirit. Let us pray. Oh, gracious and loving God, we do thank you for your love, your unconditional love. To think of all the people on this planet, all the planets and solar systems in your universe, and still you have time and attention for each and every one of us. It just boggles the mind. but we can appreciate just our relationship with you and realize our dependence on you and give authority to you to lead us and guide us in our living each and every day. So bless us, O Lord, who are poor in spirit. Amen. Well, as I said, we are in the period of Lent, and this closing hymn talks about Lent, Lord, who throughout these 40 days. So let us stand together and sing our closing hymn. Now, friends, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the love and knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ, his Son. And may the grace of God Almighty be with us and sustain us this day and every single day. Amen.